ready to worship our God. Let's move from the great outside to the inside. And as we do that, as always, thanks to the people who make this service happen. Thanks so much to Ann Hill, who's our cinematographer for the service and does all of the editing as well. Thanks to Barb Patterson. She's our primary worship assistant at this service as well. Thanks to Heidi Swartz, who is going to be reading our first lesson. Joanne Tom will join us for a children's time. And we have our band today that's sharing lots of really good music with us throughout the course of the service. We'll share communion later in the service, so you can either pause at that point or you can pause now and just have some wine or grape juice available, some bread or a cracker, and that will become your communion elements for the service. I think that's everything you need to know. We have worked our way inside. Hey, Barb, how you doing? And we are together and ready to start worship. Here we go. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share the call to worship. It's in the bulletin that's available online, or you can just listen to Barb and I. Wherever you are, pause and think of this season of COVID-19.
Oh God, deliver all who are sick or are alone or afraid, we pray.
Wherever you are, pause and think of this season of elections.
Oh God, thank you for being able to vote. May all of us live into the results with faith.
Wherever you are, pause and think of this season of autumn color.
Oh God, thank you for reminding me that change is colorful.
Wherever you are, pause and think of this season of prayer.
Oh God, give me the joy that comes from listening for your part in my prayers.
Wherever you are, pause. And then rejoice, gather yourself, and then
arise.
And that's our opening song. Thanks to our band for leading us in it.
We worship.
We really appreciate the music of our band today. Now we're going to switch over to Joanne Tom, and she's going to share a children's message with us right now. Let's see what she has in store for us today.
Hi, everyone. It's great to see you. Welcome to the children's message. Well, I'm still in my living room, but thanks to Google Images, right now I'm in a beautiful church. In our Bible story today, Jesus tells another parable. Okay, it's not in a vineyard. We've had three parables in a row in a vineyard, and this week we are at a wedding. I love weddings. Oh, look how beautiful the church is. All these flowers. Oh, I miss weddings. Oh, I miss weddings. Do you know this summer I was uninvited to three weddings? Three. Thanks, COVID. Yep. No missed opportunity to celebrate with my friends and family, missed airplane rides, missed hotel rooms, missed eating great food, missed getting all dressed up. Ugh. So in honor of missing all those opportunities, I decided, since we're at a wedding in our children's message today and in our Bible story, I'm going to get dressed up. So I curled my hair. I can't remember the last time I curled my hair, and I'm wearing my pearls. I only pull out my pearls when I go to special events like weddings, and you can't see them, but I am wearing, mind you, shoes. Oh, they are totally dancing sandals for sure. Missed out on dances. Weddings always have dances. Now, I got to tell you, I am not a very good dancer. But at a wedding, it doesn't matter. Everybody loves to dance at weddings. All right, so Jesus knows everybody loves weddings, and they're such special occasions. They take lots of planning. They cost money, but it's worth it because it's a really special, special celebration. And in Bible times, people loved weddings too. In fact, they were a bigger deal because the celebrating went on for days, days of eating and drinking and dancing and celebrating. They were a really big deal. And so, knowing what everybody knows about a wedding celebration, Jesus told a story. And it starts like this. There once was a king who had a son who was getting married, and the king planned this elaborate, enormous, awesome wedding. He's a king, so you know it's going to be big. The best food, the best wine, the best celebrating. Well, when the time came for the wedding to happen, the servants went out to gather all the friends and family and tell them that it was time for the wedding, and everyone gave excuses. No one came. They were all too busy. I've got to work on my farm. Really? Picking wheat is more important than being at a wedding celebration? Or I have to work in my store. Really? Organizing things on your shelves is more important than being at a wedding celebration? Over and over and over, excuses for why everyone was too busy to come to the wedding. Well, the king was super angry. What? I throw this big celebration and all my friends are too busy to come? So he told his servants, go out on the street and gather everyone you find. Rich, poor, doesn't matter if we know them or not. Everyone gets invited to this party. And pretty soon the celebration was filled with people enjoying themselves. So Jesus teaches us parables, or tells us parables, to teach us something about God. Jesus wanted all the people who were listening to this story to know that God is like the king in the story, who has this unbelievably awesome celebration planned for us. And everyone is invited. Everyone. No one gets left out. Ever. I love that story. There's actually another little part to this parable that Jesus is reminding us about, and it's about excuse making and being too busy. We miss out on something really spectacular when we are too busy for God. God has an amazing kingdom for us, and we are all reminded to make time for God and keep God important in our lives. Ah, this is a great lesson. How about if we fold our hands and say our prayer? Dear Jesus, thanks for telling stories that teach us how big God's love is. Help us remember we are all special. We are all important to God, each one of us, and we are all welcome in God's kingdom. Everyone has a place at God's table. Man, Jesus, we are so busy. Help us remember, no matter how busy we get, to make time for God. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thanks so much to Joanne for her message of good news for our kids. Parents and kids, you can get the full Sunday school materials for this weekend and Joanne's kind of fun tutorial video that goes with that, always available on our website and available starting each weekend for you, or on Fridays already for you to enjoy. So look for that. I think we can keep going, Barb. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. Let us pray. Maker and sustainer of the nations of the world, you made us all, not one of us the same. We let those differences divide us. We also can be indifferent. Rather than care, we just don't try. All of these things make our souls and world sick. Forgive us. Help us see what is special and good in our neighbor. Help us realize what is important and worth doing in each day of our lives. We ask it because we know your power to grant it, because of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Heidi Swartz shares today's first lesson with us. Thank you, Heidi.
The first reading is from Exodus chapter 32. Honest conversations are hard. That's why in Matthew's gospel, Jesus promises to be with us in those conversations. This account is one of the hardest of all conversations. God's righteous wrath is turned aside by Moses' honest intercession. When the people saw that Moses delayed to come down the mountain, the people gathered around Aaron and said to him, "Come, make gods for us. Who shall go before us? As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." Aaron said to them, "Take off the gold rings that are on the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me." So all the people took off the gold rings from their ears and brought them to Aaron. He took the gold from them, formed it in a mold, and cast an image of a calf. And they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt." The Lord said to Moses, "I have seen this people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone, so that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them, and of you I will make a great nation." But Moses implored the Lord his God and said, "O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, 'It was with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth'? Turn from your fierce wrath, change your mind, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, 'I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven. And all this land that I have promised, I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever.' And the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he planned to bring on his people." The word of the Lord.
Reading of the good news. It's from chapter 22 of Matthew. Jesus' adversarially showdown with the religious leaders seems to reach a climax in these verses, but he actually is only getting started. In this two-part story, Jesus takes on the leaders, but he also those who might gloat at their downfall. Once more, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go, therefore, into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding house was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind that man hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.' The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ." Let's switch locations for today's message. Maybe a canoe someplace. How does that sound? For a message that will call a little peace, calmness, and quiet. Enjoy. A little peace and quiet and calm is a nice thing to find in life. So I was recently going through an old box, sorting through some college stuff. Not mine, it was my mom's stuff. What had happened was that my larger family, my brother and sister, we had discovered these few couple of boxes from our parents, and they gave me the job of sorting through all of it. Imagine that. You've all seen my desk, right? Who puts me in charge of a decluttering project? But so it was. And I began to look through all this stuff, and I found items from when my mom was a student at the University of Wisconsin-Madison from 1936 to 1940. Papers, exams, and then really interesting stuff, like this thing she got as a freshman with instructions on how girls should conduct themselves on campus. Smoking or not smoking. The length of your dress. How to handle a blind date. That whole booklet is a forum unto itself. And then the booklet from her commencement. In 1940, June 17th, a Monday, and I thought it was interesting what an agricultural state Wisconsin still was at that point, because after letters and sciences and education, the next biggest group of graduates was from the School of Agricultural Science. It was such a reminder of the world that my parents lived in. And I thought, June 1940, the British, just 2 weeks before, had retreated from Dunkirk. Churchill was about to make his famous "This is our finest hour" speech. In June 1940, Paris and all of France would fall to the Nazis, and in a obscure Polish village, the Nazis opened a camp near the small town called Auschwitz. A little peace and quiet and calm is a nice thing, right? I was just thinking that my mom, in that case, graduated into a world where the Great Depression still hung over everything, and World War II was already going in the Pacific and in Europe and in Africa. And many of the people she graduated with, I presume, would end up dying in that war or being forever marked by it. A little peace and quiet and calm is a nice thing, right? So I'm canoeing in a place called Gilbert's Lake with my favorite cinematographer, Barb Horner-Ibler, behind the camera. And Gilbert's Lake is connected by a little channel that we're going through that goes to Big Cedar Lake up near West Bend. And depending on the time of the year in the water here, you can see striped bass spawning or maybe a turtle sunning itself on a rock. Almost any time of the year, you can see the heron gliding over the water looking for a meal. It's a beautiful place, peaceful and calm and quiet. In the Bible, the word shalom, the core Hebrew word for peace, is not a passive word. It doesn't really even mean absence of war or calmness of heart so much as it means wholeness of life and spirit. In other words, shalom is something you actively have to choose time and time again. And you have to be part of a community effort to make it happen. 1940 to 2020. This year from hell, right? COVID. Social unrest, and rightly so, backlash, and arguments over things that have been going on my whole lifetime. And because of COVID, social isolation, and school, and work from home, and unemployment, it's a difficult, difficult time. But Paris hasn't fallen. Auschwitz is back to just being a town in Poland. In other words, every time has its troubles and challenges. If you'd go back another 80 years from 1940, you'd be at what? 1860. Slavery would still be in existence and our Civil War would be about to happen. If you went back another 80 years, we'd be in the middle of our Revolutionary War and France would be poised for an even bloodier civil war of their own. Peace, and calm, and quiet, it's a nice thing, and we should seek it out and appreciate it wherever we can. Our scriptures lived in a difficult world too. It's interesting how both of today's scriptures give you a sense of how you have to seize shalom in life, real, significant, meaningful peace. So in the first one from Exodus, the people of Israel, who are always really a symbol for all of us, we're at some level all God's chosen people, of course. The people of Israel, within 40 days when Moses goes up on the mountain, they forget everything. They forget Moses, they forget God, they build the golden calf, and God is wroth. God is very wroth at them. And God is going to blow them off the face of the earth, and Moses prays hard. Moses prays hard and changes the mind of God. Maybe the part of the lesson in that for us is that if God can change the divine mind, then maybe sometimes our minds have to change too, right? That's what prayer does. It changes the world, but it changes us first. And then in today's gospel lesson, it's such a violent and seemingly confusing passage where Jesus tells this parable of a king who who orders the slaves to bring all the guests into his son's wedding banquet, and they blow it off, and he destroys their town, and then he sends the slaves back out. I mean, there's nothing good about this story, and like pulls people in from the highways and the byways, and then there's this one guy who doesn't have the right wedding garment, and he gets thrown into outer darkness where people will gnash their teeth forever. Whoa! But see, Jesus, he's talking to us. I mean, the parables told against the Pharisees and the chief priests, you know, it's a layup, you guys. If you won't accept the good news, then it's going to go to everybody else. And that's not unique to the chief priests and the scribes. It's unique to all of us in life when we've so owned something. And then some good news comes into it that's different than what we've heard, and we've become very defensive and protective. But Jesus not only knew that happens in life, but he also knew that when the good news is then shared with somebody else who didn't previously have it, that there's sometimes a tendency for the people who are new to it to overreact to it, to gloat about their sudden good favor. They're like the guy who doesn't have the proper wedding garment. In other words, just because you suddenly included doesn't mean that you now get to exclude the people who came before you. There's this power in Jesus' message that includes everyone and doesn't allow anyone to be left out. And that's hard for us because we either hold it to ourselves or we gloat about the people who lost it. And Jesus says, none of that is even close to the kingdom of heaven. So while digging through all of that stuff, I also found a couple of old fishing licenses from my grandfather, Rudy. I never knew Rudy, but I'm told that he would launch his wooden rowboat and he'd row out into the lake and maybe to a place like this, and he'd cast a line. And I suppose in the late 1930s, if he did that, he would have had some things to worry about, like his daughter in the big city of Madison, smoking, wearing dresses that weren't the right length, maybe going out on blind dates. A little peace and quiet and calm. It's a good thing, right? See, there's probably never going to be a time in your life or mine where that is the definition of the world that surrounds us. And escapism isn't peace. Suppression of differences isn't peace. Gloating isn't peace. You have to make shalom happen. And you and I know how to do that. As annoying as all the voices are out there, if ours remain silent because we're sick of it or disgusted by it, then really important voices won't be heard. And I often think that people who are hurt or quiet, they just don't want to talk. And so one of the most important things about listening is to just be silent sometimes and to see the silence as the connection and the healing that it is. A little peace and calm and quiet, you see, is a good thing. It's how you make shalom. But you don't necessarily do it alone or for yourself. So maybe another 80 years from now, Barb, what do you think? A grandchild of ours might be paddling in the same spot. And if they do, I hope there'll still be striped bass that are spawning and turtles warming themselves in the sun. And maybe a heron shopping for a little lunch. But should there be such a grandchild someday, I hope they will look back on our world, our generation, and realize that we were not a people who could not be changed by prayer, who didn't need to gloat, but instead knew how to make peace, to listen most of the time, to speak so that good voices are not absent from the conversation. In other words, I hope those grandchildren might look back on us and just say of our whole era, they were people who knew how to get things done. Welcome back to this place and to our band with a song called Offering.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. COVID-19 is surging in our area. Thank you for all the medical people who serve patients and families at risk to themselves as a sacrifice by the families who see them less. Fill them beyond measure with skill and compassion. Heal those with the disease. Ease their discomfort and help them to heal. Comfort those who have lost someone to it. May science find a path to healing soon. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Thank you for your creation, O God. The beautiful colors of autumn amaze and delight us. It is the best art show ever. At the same time, the creation also included fires on the West Coast and another hurricane to the Gulf Coast. Ease the impact of these traumas on the people in their path, most of all, but also the animals and crops, the businesses and homes that lie in their path. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer. Oh God, we pray a little bit more for our country. We just thank you for our freedoms to be able to debate and to vote. Where we are troubled and facing difficulties, help us to not give up on each other, but to double down on each other and become stronger because of it. And guide us so that we each can change ourselves, and in changing a little bit by each person, may it be a life-giving change to all. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Great God, we pray for those who are sick everywhere, for healing, for support, for love, for your presence, for them not to feel forgotten or alone. We think of everyone we know in our lives and as a faith community, and we just pause in this moment to remember all of them and to hold them tight and to lift them up in our prayers before you. O God, be there all and in all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we have prayed, because we trust in your mercy through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Thanks for spending time together in prayer. Let's handle a little news and announcements in the life of our faith community. A couple of servant things that are important, and soon the blood drive for the fall is October 17th, so this coming Saturday from 7 to noon in the Cross of Life Fellowship Hall. Please sign up at our website. We can't take walk-ins due to COVID restrictions. We're about half signed up at this point, so thanks to all who have signed up, and we can still use lots more people to share at the blood drive. And then on October 24th and 29th, I think that's a Saturday and Thursday here in October, we need help at the Waukesha Food Pantry. You can sign up for that on our website as well. Barb, how about you? What might you have?
Well, we have an adult forum coming up this month, and the forum's name is What It's Like Being Married to a Pastor.
What's that like? What's that like, Barb?
Pastor John's wife, myself, and Pastor Muriel's husband will be having a discussion via Zoom on October 18th at 11 o'clock to 11:45 a.m. So we hope that you will join us. Thank you.
Sounds great. Go to our website for all the other news and announcements. Things are constantly changing these days and may continue to change even more. We always want to support each other and be safe with each other. Now I think it's time for a meal, the best of meals. So if you want to get your communion elements ready, we'll pause for just a moment as you do that. And now we begin the meal together. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
On that last night, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks for it. He broke it and he shared it, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Whenever you eat of it, do so for the remembrance of me." Later in that same meal, he took the cup, gave thanks, shared, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink of it, do so for the remembrance of me." Remember him always in your praying and in your living, especially with this prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. People of God, we are together at the table, and so we eat all at once the body of Christ given for you. Eat and be fed. The blood of Christ shed for you. We drink together of the cup of forgiveness. give thanks for one body, one bread. Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace and peace. Amen. Receive the benediction. May the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord's face shine on us, be gracious to us. May the Lord look on us and on this world with the greatest of favor and give us peace. Amen. Thanks so much to our band today, to Melissa Bemis, Pat Dowling, Mark Krause, Matt Griepentrog, Brandon Stobbs, and Kevin and Stacy Nordmeyer for the music they've shared with us. They send us forth with the song, Days of Elijah.
Thanks be to God.